Today we're discussing this new Sony 24-70 f2.8 G Master version 2, which is basically a refresh like we recently saw with the 70-200. And while it might not be quite as impressive of an update compared to that 70-200 Mark II, it does still manage to eke out the title of best 24-70 available for Sony E. For disclosure, Sony lent me this lens to make this review. I don't get to keep it. No money changed hands, and Sony does not get any input on this video's production or get to preview it before it's posted. This video does have a sponsor though, and that's Storyblocks. The most notable difference about this new lens is the build. It is significantly smaller and lighter than both the previous G Master and the reigning champ for a 24-70 on this system, in my opinion, the Sigma 2.8. Let's weigh them all now, and I will give you the weights with the caps on them. So starting with the new lens, this one weighs 730 grams, which is 1.6 pounds. The older G Master is 2 pounds, or 923 grams, and then the Sigma 2.8 is 854 grams, or 1.8 pounds. So they rank like this, but the difference between the new G Master and the older G Master is massive, and you can really feel it when it's on the camera. It balances a lot better and is a lot easier to handle and is much preferred from a user experience perspective. It's also more feature rich than those other lenses as well and brings it much more in line with their other modern G Master lenses with the inclusion of a declickable aperture ring with the iris lock function, two dedicated function buttons, and an AF-MF switch. And they've also added this new lever that says smooth and tight, which increases the friction on the zoom ring so you can adjust it to your preference. And the textures feel more refined and modern. Oh, and the front filter diameter is 82 millimeters, which is the same as the other two lenses. Manual focusing is also much improved. On the original G Master, the focus ring was non-linear, making repeatable focus pulls nearly impossible. This new lens is now completely linear with a focus throw of about 140 to 150 degrees. Now, the Sigma isn't exactly linear either, but it has a very long throw and a more intuitive acceleration. So manual focusing is quite viable on the Sigma, but I'd still give the win to the new G Master. However, the Sigma takes back a huge win when it comes to being parfocal. The Sigma was better than the original G Master because the old G Master wouldn't keep focus between different focal lengths where the Sigma did. Unfortunately, this new G Master still has that issue. Focusing at one end of the zoom range and then zooming to the other will cause you to lose focus. Now, autofocus can help compensate for this, obviously, but for manual focus, that's a concern. The Sigma also beat the old G Master when it came to minimum focusing distance and reproduction ratio, but the new G Master has come back to surpass the Sigma in this regard at 70mm. The actual specific numbers: at 70mm, it's 0.3 meters or 0.99 feet minimum focusing distance. And at 24mm, it's 0.21 meters or 0.69 feet. Now you're gonna get a better reproduction at 70mm. Now regarding focus breathing, I didn't see a huge difference between the older and newer version of this lens. Perhaps this was an area where they didn't feel needed much improvement. Both do seem quite usable. Although the more I look at it, the original lens might actually have less breathing, but it's minor regardless. Overall, they aren't perfect, but the breathing is minimized. This was using the A1, by the way, which doesn't have that breathing compensation of the A7IV. But this is my monthly reminder to Sony that I'd like to see that added in firmware, please, as I'm a bit disappointed about the continued lack of this feature as an owner of your apparent flagship camera. Now, moving over to autofocus, this lens is now using Sony's latest and greatest focus motors, the Linear XDs, where the previous lens was using the older tech. However, anyone who's used the previous G Master knows that for most purposes, it still focused quite quickly and reliably. So did the Sigma, for that matter. So I found it quite difficult to notice a huge difference when using this new lens. It is a bit snappier when going from minimum to maximum, and it is a bit quieter as well, but these differences are minor. And generally speaking, people aren't buying this lens for birding or sports. It's more for portraits, weddings, travel, or just general walking around. And for all those purposes, any of these lenses will do, in my opinion. But yes, this new lens is the best. I just can't guarantee that you'll notice. As for video, pretty much the same deal. But here, let me absurdly move about the frame to test the video autofocus while I tell you about today's sponsor, Storyblocks.
Sometimes you don't have the shot you need and there's no way you're gonna be able to go out and get it before you run out of time, run out of money, or run out of patience by completely derailing your creative momentum. And that's where Storyblocks comes in. They've got subscriptions for every budget, giving you access to a vast royalty-free library with unlimited downloads, allowing you to use the footage worry-free for both personal and commercial projects. And this is all easily accessed using their intuitive interface with filters for 4K video at multiple frame rates, along with backgrounds and After Effects templates. If you've never browsed Storyblocks before, I think you'd be truly impressed by just how exhaustive their library is, and I encourage you to learn more about them by using the link in the description below.
All right, now regarding image quality, this new G Master lens is the sharpest. In the center, all three of these lenses are strong performers, but the older G Master really starts to soften as you move out toward the edge of the frame. The Sigma was better in this regard, but now the new G Master is the best. You're going to see the biggest improvement going from the old G Master to the new, and only minor improvements if you're considering upgrading from the Sigma. Color rendering on the new lens is essentially perfect, and it's more neutral than the Sigma, which did tend to lean a bit warmer. But the new lens matches quite well with the other G Masters, including the older 24-70. The biggest disappointment for me was chromatic aberration. It's not that it's bad, it's just that it really isn't improved that much. Perhaps there's some limit in optics when it comes to making a 24-70 f2.8 lens, because I've yet to find one for Sony E that doesn't have at least some issues with chromatic aberration. It is improved, which is great, but it's only about 30% better than the other two lenses I've been discussing. Sony's other recent G Masters, including the new 70-200, have this issue mostly licked, so it must be hard to remove on this particular focal range, as you do still get some color fringing laterally, albeit to a lesser extent than the previous lenses. This type of aberration can mostly be removed in post, but you also get some longitudinal fringing as well, which can only be reduced by stopping down. So I can't really call this a deal breaker, because this is the best you're going to get from a 24-70 for Sony E, but I do wish it was a little bit better. And it makes me wonder how Tamron was able to solve this problem on their newer 35-150, but then again, that lens is almost incomparably larger. In the Bokeh category, the new G Master wins again. All three of these lenses are solid, but you'll get the best results with the new lens. Smooth circles that mostly maintain their shape out toward the edges, but even when stopping down, the iris maintains a very circular appearance, which is great. Transitions to out-of-focus areas are very smooth and pleasing, and detail is maintained where important, when close focusing without compromising those focus transitions. And like you'd expect from a G Master, flare is very well controlled and contrast is maintained even in harsh conditions. And finally, here's the sun when stopped down for you Sunstar aficionados. Okay, let's wrap up. I've already made a comparison video of the 24-70 options when the big choices were the original G Master, the Sigma, and the Tamron 28-75. And from that point on, I was using and recommending the Sigma. Not only did it manage to beat the old G Master in several key categories, but it was significantly cheaper. And it wasn't any bigger or heavier, so it was kind of a no-brainer, in my opinion. The main drawback to the Sigma, which I didn't know at that time, was that apparently some batches had issues with dust getting in between the elements. Now, I never had that problem, but I know it did make some people pay extra for the G Master just to get that better weather sealing. But other than that, the Sigma was a slam dunk. Well, now it gets complicated, because this new Sony lens has an answer to pretty much all the Sigma's previous advantages, except for one, price. This new G Master is sharper, has better overall image quality, focuses better, has more controls, and most notably is significantly smaller and lighter. And while I haven't tested to say it for sure, I'm predicting you'll get that improved weather sealing and likely won't have any dust issues like you might have had with the Sigma. It isn't parfocal, which is something the Sigma still prevails at, but other than that, it's just a better lens. However, the Sigma is $1,100 US at the time of recording this, and this new G Master, I'm told, is going to be $2,300, so more than double the price. Is this new G Master more than double the optical quality of the Sigma? No, not even close. I'd say if you were going on image quality, this new Sony is worth $200 to $300 more than the Sigma. But the build quality and size and weight are the tricky factors here. I have no idea how much you personally value those aspects, and it's those aspects that make this lens more impressive, that it managed to still be 15% better while reducing the size and weight so much. So if the most important factor to you is handling or equipment load, then you're definitely getting your money's worth with this new lens. But if not, then it might be a little bit harder to justify. Overall, it's a great lens, and I like it a lot. And if money is no concern, buy this one. But I wouldn't rush to upgrade if you already own one of these other two lenses, and it wouldn't be my first value choice, which is still the Sigma, unless again, I really needed that size and weight reduction. So in the end, I obviously can't determine the priorities of every user, but I hope this information was helpful in your decision-making process. All right, I'm done.